Take a few minutes to make sure that your tweezers are sharp and properly dressed. If you have uneven tips, it's going to make it a lot harder to pick up small parts like screws and springs, and of course that increases your likelihood of losing a part. Before you even start removing screws, put the screwdriver tips into the different size screw slots and make sure they're not loose. If the tips are loose in the slot, you risk having the screwdriver slip out and damaging a part. If you're working on a newer movement, grab yourself a copy of the tech sheet and familiarize yourself with the parts and any special lubrication instructions. By keeping your workbench free of clutter, there are less things that a part can hide behind if one gets away from you. All you really need during disassembly is your movement holder, your screwdriver, your tweezers, and a part tray. Invest a minute of your time to clean off your workbench and mat with Windex to keep your work area as clean as possible. The last thing you want to do is introduce more dirt or hair or dust into your parts and then into your cleaning solutions. Take lots of pictures with your phone for reference. You might think you will remember where everything goes, but this is probably the number one problem new watchmakers deal with when trying to reassemble a movement. When you remove a screw, look to see if the screw head is beveled on the underside or if the top is flat or rounded. Check to see if the screw has a shoulder on it because those screws are very specific. You also want to look at any difference in screw length if you're removing multiple screws that are holding down a single part. Before you take your first screw out, don't forget to let down the power to the mainspring. Once the power is let down, remove the balance wheel and pallet fork before you start removing any other systems in the watch and put them in a secure place. This will just lessen the chances of you damaging them during your disassembly process. Try to work in as calm an area as possible. Let your family know what you're doing and ask them not to disturb you. If you like to listen to music, play something that will help you concentrate. This is not the time to be rocking Van Halen. The ideal bench height when you're using a loop is just below your shoulder level when you're sitting in a chair. If you have to crouch or bend over the top of the movement, that's going to lead to you becoming uncomfortable, and it's probably going to make you start working faster than you really should, which is going to lead to mistakes. If you're using a machine to clean your parts, load your small parts in a cleaning basket by system. Certain parts like small springs don't need to go into the baskets as they're just going to make their way out of that thin wire mesh and they're going to get lost. Start developing your inspection process now by inspecting each part as you remove it. Check that each system functions properly before you remove any of the parts. Pegging the jewel holes is a step that's often overlooked by new watchmakers because they don't understand that not doing it is going to affect their amplitude. It's always best to peg the jewels right during your pre-cleaning regimen and before you do your final clean and rinse. When putting the movement back together, assemble one system at a time and check to make sure that it's functioning correctly before moving on to the next system. The typical assembly order is usually going to be the keyless works first, then the barrel and bridge parts, the powertrain, the pallet fork, and then the balance wheel. Once the balance is installed, stop. There's no need to move any further into your assembly until you know what you've already installed is working properly. The fewer parts that you would have to troubleshoot, the better. The closer to the center point of the regulator that you are, the more effective your adjusting and regulating of the vertical positions will be. This is the point where the movement should be the most isochronal. Always start with the regulator in the middle between the plus and minus signs. Trying to regulate a watch with magnetized parts is impossible to do, so make the demagnetizing of your movement part of your regular routine because it's often overlooked. Once you've assembled and lubricated the movement, take it to a full wind and allow it to run for a minimum of 24 hours before you try to regulate the watch. This is because lubricants need time to settle into their positions between the arbor and the jewels. The mainspring needs time to stretch and settle into its position in the barrel. You also want to be able to check the amplitude after the movement's been running for 24 hours to make sure that the mainspring has enough power. Although it does vary a little from movement to movement, in general, after 24 hours from a full wind, a handwound movement should be around 210 degrees, and an automatic movement should be around 190 degrees. If it's not, you need to figure out why before you go any further. Don't expect miracles. If you're brand new and you're buying $20 non-runners, the chances of you fixing that movement are so small, you might as well just have some fun. Remember that most non-runners were sold by people exactly like you who tried to fix it and couldn't, or they took a part from it and they just resold it as a non-runner. So give yourself some time to figure things out and just have fun.